Yes, I was introduced, and I work for the Norwegian Biotechnology Advisory Board. We are an independent body that give advice to the government on matters concerning the use of biotechnology and gene technology. And I think it's pretty safe to say that rarely does a single technology have such a big impact on our work as genome editing, which we will discuss today. So in order to understand why genome editing is going to be a game changer, it already is a game changer, we need to look back. No, my slides are not on the board. Some technical issues here today. Yeah, well, they're not on there. Yeah. Ah, there we go. Okay, yeah. So at least this is what I'm trying to state today, is that genome editing is going to be a game-changer technology. To understand why it is going to be game-changing, we need to look back first and look at what we already have, because we have been able to manipulate DNA for quite a few decades. We've had something called genetic modification, which normally involves inserting genes in a random fashion into an organism's DNA. And then you hope that this gene will change or will give an extra trait to this organism. We've, for instance, been able to make plants with a few different traits. And we have a couple of examples of gene therapy which shows some promise, where you give new genes to a patient that has lacks gene function. But we have not so far been able to do any targeted changes to our DNA. For instance, if you have a mutation that causes disease, we have not been able to change that mutation. But that was, of course, until about 4 years ago, when genome editing technology was developed. And there are a couple of different genome editing technologies, something called sync fingers and TALEN technology, but I will not talk about them today. Today we are here to talk about CRISPR, which is the genome editing technology that is having by far the biggest impact on research and applied biotechnology. And I would like especially to draw your attention to the front page of Science, which announced that CRISPR is there. A breakthrough technology of the year for 2015. So I'm going to try to explain very briefly. We don't have a lot of time today, but I will try to explain briefly what CRISPR actually is, because it normally comes from a natural biological system. It's used by bacteria to defend themselves against viruses, because when a virus attacks a bacteria, it inserts its DNA and to replicate itself and destroy the bacteria. If the bacteria has met this virus before, some of them have a system called CRISPR, where they use enzymes to cut the viral DNA to defend themselves. And in 2012, some very clever people, they were mentioned before, Emmanuel Charpentier and Jennifer Doudna, together with some people from the Broad Institute, especially a guy called Feng Zhang, they showed that this DNA cutting system can be programmed to cut any piece of DNA. So, in principle, what you have is this enzyme called Cas9, which is then a bacterial enzyme. And you design a little piece of RNA, which is a molecular cousin of DNA, which can bind to a matching sequence in the DNA strand. So if you design your RNA strand to match whatever sequence you want in the DNA of an organism, this will then bind to the DNA, and the Cas9 enzyme will cut both strands of the DNA double helix. So what you end up with is a double-strand cut. And the double-strand cut is quite familiar to the cell. It happens every day when your cells divide. They get double-strand cuts. So our cells, they have evolved a system to repair these cuts, because a double-strand cut is not something the cell really wants. So it has one system where it sticks the DNA ends back together in quite a crude fashion, and you often end up losing a little bit of DNA on the way. And if that happens inside the gene, you will deactivate the gene very often. But it also has a system where it can use something called homologous recombination to insert DNA, or it uses other strands of DNA to repair the cut. And as a researcher, you can manipulate this to insert whatever piece you want. So if we then compare it to the old technology, where you insert your gene in a random fashion somewhere in the DNA, gene editing technology allows us to make very precise mutations, and you can delete pieces of DNA, or you can substitute single base pairs, or you can insert new genetic material, but in a quite a precise way. So on Tuesday, there was something called the Cutting Edge Festival in Forskningsparken, and we had someone from the Roslin Institute, a professor called Bruce Whitelaw, and he also gave a keynote talk about the CRISPR technology. And he is using this technology to edit livestock, and he, in his words, this technology now allows us to make whatever changes we want anywhere in the DNA of any organism. We can do it cheaply, precisely, and efficiently. Because this is what is special about CRISPR compared to the other genome editing technologies. It's very accessible. You can buy the most basic components of this molecular system online for a few hundred dollars. It's being used by even undergraduate students. These are iGEM students. Many of you probably know iGEM. Yeah. And this is a picture of an American dad with his son. They're trying to edit E. coli on their living room carpet. And this is a graph showing the number of publications on PubMed using CRISPR. And ever since 2012, it's just gone straight up. This year, we're nearing 2,000 already. So it really is being employed on a grand scale. And the other thing that's very special about CRISPR is, like I said, it works in every single living organism. So we are no longer restricted to the standard model organisms that we have been using. We've typically been using fruit flies or certain types of plants or mice to study different gene functions. Now we can do it in whatever species we want. And of course, it's not only research, it's also being applied in different areas, one of which is food production. Bruce Whitelaw, which I mentioned, he has made gene-edited pigs that are resistant to a couple of very serious diseases. He's trying to improve animal welfare and food security. There has also been different crops developed, for instance, that are resistant to disease, or that are low in gluten, for instance. Other allergy-free foodstuffs, like eggs, where you can also produce vaccines for people who cannot tolerate eggs or vaccines normally. And in Norway, researchers at the Marine Research Institute, they are trying to develop salmon using CRISPR that can contribute to a more sustainable fish farming industry. So there's a lot of things happening in this field. And the big question now is, should these organisms be regulated as genetically modified organisms? Because we have quite strict regulations. And for instance, if you make a point mutation that has arisen in nature also, if you have the same product, should it be regulated as a GMO? The jury is out on this question. In some countries, like the US and even Sweden, they have decided not to regulate certain gene-edited organisms as GMO. The researchers are free to plant their crops. In the EU, they cannot really decide. Here in Norway, we're just waiting to see what the EU does, and then we will have to discuss it. So it will be interesting to see how this pans out. It can also, of course, be used on humans. And a lot of labs are using CRISPR now as a research tool to understand more about how genes affects us both when in health and in sickness, and especially in terms of disease, it's going to have a big impact. And one of the reasons is that CRISPR can also be used on many genes at the same time, and we have not been able to do that before. So for instance, diseases like cancer or heart disease or neuropsychiatric disorders, which are caused by a combination of many different genes, we are able to study that in a lot greater detail than before. So we will have a lot of new knowledge about how genes affect disease. And of course, a lot of people are trying to develop therapies using CRISPR because there are a lot of genetic disorders, and different companies have now licensed the technology to try and develop different types of therapies. So one that's nearing the clinic is a therapy for inherited eye disorders that can cause blindness. They have announced that they will start clinical trials next year. Another area of intense research is for blood disorders that are caused by single genetic mutations, like this sickle cell anemia, where they will try to reverse the genetic error that causes the disease. And that's also getting closer to clinical trials. But first up is cancer treatment, where researchers will use CRISPR to tailor the patient's immune cells to be able to recognize the cells, the cancer cells better and destroy them. And this has already started now in China. They have started clinical trials on lung cancer patients. And in the US, they also have approval from the ethics board to start a similar experiment. So that's one thing. But people are maybe most excited about the prospect of using CRISPR to treat inherited genetic disorders, many of which are very serious and for which there are no current treatments. So one example is something called Duchenne muscular dystrophy. It's caused by a single mutation on the X chromosome. It affects about 1 in 4,000 males, which is quite a lot. And it's a lethal disorder, and they die from muscle wasting. And most of them die before they reach the age of 30. And there is no current treatment for this disorder. So researchers tried in mice. They got their stem cells out in a blood sample, and they edited the genetic error that causes this disease. And then they grew new muscle cells from these stem cells in the lab and transplanted them back into the mice. And they were significantly better. They were not entirely well, but they were better. At the same time, another research group, they did the same change, but they did it not in the stem cells. They did it in the mice embryos before they were born. And of course, they came out entirely healthy. And this shows one of the big ethical dilemmas that we now face, because CRISPR also works in the germline. It works in sperm cells, egg cells, and in embryos, also in humans. So the question is, if we can then eradicate some of these inherited serious disorders by erasing these genetic errors, should we do it? Is it safe to do it? Do we know enough about the consequences? People cannot really disagree on this question. And a lot of people are worried about what if we start, where's the distinction between disease and normal traits? If we start going down this path, will we end up editing things that have nothing to do with disease? And so germline editing will, in some sense, be taking control of our own evolution, because whatever changes you make will go and be passed down to all your descendants. But if that's a difficult question, you can consider this. Should we also be masters of all evolution, not just our own? Researchers have now, using CRISPR, managed to devise a method for spreading out genetic edits in wild populations. And they do that with a system called Gene Drive. And many of them want to, for instance, cure malaria. They want to take out the malaria mosquito entirely to stop the spread of malaria, which is a very could be an enormous benefit to public health. But, of course, there could be serious consequences if you change ecosystems in that way. And authorities all over the globe are scratching their heads. They don't know what to do about this technology, how to regulate it, and it's going to be a big part of the discussion in the coming years. So the take-home message is that this technology is coming, and it's coming fast. There will be a lot of opportunities for good, But we need to decide together as a society where to draw the line. So please join me and everyone else in the debate on how to use this technology responsibly. And thank you. You can follow us also on Facebook and Twitter, and we have a magazine if you want to more information on these topics. Thank you.
So thank you very much for this nice talk. Will you please just remind on the scene for 1 minute? Sigrid, could you please just remain on the scene for just 1 minute, please?
Yeah.
So I just want to ask you one little question, and I hope you have time for a little follow-up after the next talk, so we can sort of finish it with a small debate about the ethical problems. But I just wonder, how do you think that this will change our everyday life in, let's say, 15 years?
15?
Yes.
Years? I think we will see a lot of applied biotechnology using this CRISPR method, especially in food production. I think we will see a lot. Maybe we will see how it goes with the regulation, but at least worldwide we will see a lot of products. And I think also medical treatments, I think we will have, at least for diseases that are easy to treat in the way that you can maybe get your stem cells out of your body and fix them in the lab and then put them back. Those kind of diseases, I think we will have a lot of things happening over the next 15 years. Whether or not we will be able to cure all disease remains to be seen. I think that's a bit further in the future.
Thank you. Just one more question, because I'm very curious about this. A lot of people regard the DNA as sort of the program recipe for a human being, and when you can program things on computers with zeros and ones, could you be able to do you think that we will regard gene editing as programming in the future?
To a certain extent, I think yes. I think people are, it's so easy to do whenever you design this RNA thread, for instance, you use your computer program. You just type in the sequence and you get something in the mail, which you then do your experiments with. But reprogramming an entire human being, that's a bit more difficult. Because if you do it on an adult, it will take some more than just typing in zeros and ones to change your biology. But yeah.
So maybe it takes a few more years before we become true biorobots. I hope so. Thank you very much. We have a very small gift for you.
Thank you.
So thank you for your talk.
Thanks.
And welcome back on scene. Another applause for Sigrid.
Thank you.